Hi guys, this is Tony Leonard presenting through ZBrush Live, ZBrush for 2D. I'm Tony Leonard. I'm a concept artist here based in Los Angeles, California. Thank you for joining me. Thanks for everybody joining me here today. If you give me just a second, I'm going to try to figure out a few technical issues. Just make sure that I'm straight. If you can, give me a word in the chat and let me know if you guys are around and if you can hear me and see me clearly. And then we'll get started. Everything seems to be dialed in so far. Hola, Zulu. ¿Cómo estamos? Ah, good stuff. Okay. So, actually, let me head over here. And, I'm just gonna do like this. Alright, guys. You guys can see me. Everything's good. Sound is good. Hope that everything is correct with my mic and video. But if not, please, by all means, let me know in the chat and I'll try to fix things out. You'll have to excuse my Los Angeles Spanish, but that's about the extent of it. Good deal. Okay, so for today, I had only something sort of in short planned. But I kind of want to be able to answer some questions for you guys on just sort of like how I work. Usually building some like hard surface characters through doing like a concept mesh. And you guys kind of saw me do some of this in the last couple of streams where I did a hard surface design like you know, like a drone or a cyborg or something like that. And I just take like simple bits of clay and start working from that, or either like a Z-sphere gesture, sketching it out with Z-spheres. Today, I thought I might change it up a little bit of my workflow, just a little bit, and try to utilize a few more things using some simple shapes, like insert shapes, and also using like some Boolean cuts. So, you know, like maybe if we wanted to use Booleans impartial to build some parts and then have like a blocked out form that we can build upon, doing something like that, creating union meshes if anybody had any questions about that, or if you're new to using ZBrush, you know, there's a lot of tips in here for like hard surface. So I'm gonna do like sort of like a 2 hour crunch in the time that we have. I guess by now it's 5 minutes after, so we'll make it 1 hour and like 55 minutes or so. But I'm just gonna jump right in, and first, probably, you know, just I'm gonna take one of the existing projects from ZBrush. So you know, each time that you open ZBrush, you can always hit the comma and come up with some of the default projects that are in here. And it's probably worth it if you're new to ZBrush to kind of have a look through these and see what they are and what their usefulness is. Of course, referencing some of the ZBrush documentation on the Pixelogic site. But I'm just going to grab sort of like a Dynamesh sphere, and this is like a 32 resolution mesh, Dynamesh mesh, and it's just a sphere. So it's set up in a project, so I can add to that project. So I'll just double tap it and open it. Hey Craig, how's it going? Benjamin, thank you for letting me know that things sound good. So, you know, I have a couple of different monitors to see chats in between Facebook and also Twitch as well, but But if you guys have any questions, I'm going to try to keep my eyes peeled in this direction because I have a monitor over here. And look forward to ZBrush, which is in front of me. And we'll go from there. But I'll try not to skip any questions and be able to answer everything that I can. Okie doke. All right, so let's get started. So I'm just going to turn off floor, turn off dynamic. Two things that can kind of get in the way unless I have more of an established model. And of course, this is Dynamesh. So if you were to look in your geometry under the Dynamesh tab, you'll see that it's highlighted. And usually a lot of times I like to set this a little bit, like I'll turn on project. Sometimes with hard surface, I'll use polish. And also I'll use blur. But in this case, I'm not going to use blur. I'm just going to turn it down to zero and keep that 32 resolution, which I can change later as I need resolution, correct? Right. So I'm going to go here, maybe start by clipping off a few things just to get some general shapes. So I'm going to use clip curve. Now the thing with clip curve is some of you may or may not know. I'm not going to make assumptions about anybody's workflows or their level, but to start off with, the clip curve brush is just basically almost like a flattening geometry brush. It takes and it clips brushes, not to be confused with like either slice or trim. But I'll just do a little demo here and we can undo it and then we can keep going. So if I was to take this, and it works in symmetry, if I can take this and I can clip it, and basically what it does is, if you look at the polyframes, that's Shift F, basically what it did was flatten all of the geometry, and from here I could use Redynamesh, which is just like holding the control key and off into the canvas area. If I click and drag, what it'll do is it'll reorder the points of the base mesh. And you see how it gets a lot of pinching along the flat, hard edge. And I can try to, you know, Dynamesh that again, and it would reorder the points again, right? So you can use this as sort of a basis to build off of a lot of different shapes and create custom shapes. If we were doing, say, perhaps something like, here, I'll flatten the top, maybe like right about there. And then I'll take and switch tools and go, say, to a very similar tool, which is like Slice. Now, Slice is basically, it'll cut the geometry and basically create a new polygroup, right? So if I come up here and slice it, and there I have an actual sliced piece of geometry with a totally different polygroup. And I can redynamesh that, and it may reorder some of the polygroups depending on like the resolution of pixels and whatnot. But if I wanted to just keep it, I can keep it, hide apart, you know, and maybe work with this by just splitting it and then closing holes and then keeping that as a separate Dynamesh piece, right? So I'm going to be doing a lot of things like that, even some kind of old school stuff where if you take a slice and you want a difficult curve, because a lot of this, the algorithms, they don't, the more complex the shape that you try to use as a slice, sometimes it can be a little bit difficult to work with geometrically. So if I take this and maybe do a few more cuts, like here, and then another one here, and then another one here maybe, I can take and hide some of the other areas and sort of create custom shapes out of all of these slice cuts. Like let's say I wanted a mechanical dip in the cut lines, I could polygroup this. The slice is still there, but it's still the same polygroup. Then I could take and hide the other. And then I'll do something like polygrouping this. And if I'm moving too fast for anyone, just please stop me and you know, I'll stop rambling, but then I'll answer some questions for you if you get confused. So, believe me. I want everybody to try to be able to pick up some like little handy tips here and move on. So, anyway, I'm going to go here and just make these two different, but like I can probably come in and just say, grab that and close holes on it, or keep groups on this Dynamesh, redynamesh it. And it's really actually kind of cool because something like this, if you created a custom like polygrouped area using slices, you could probably come back and do like panel looping with that or something like that. Probably shouldn't have Dynameshed this. I should probably closed holes on it, because sometimes depending on the shapes you can get some really nasty results just like this. So I'm going to actually undo that just really quick. Maybe take this, Actually, you know what? I think I'll select it and mask it. Now, this is something kind of neat within ZBrush as a feature. Like, you can actually take your transpose tool or the gizmo, and holding control and clicking on a polygroup, it will mask it off. So I could do something like maybe splitting. So a lot of times up here, I'll do like split unmasked points, and it'll split it into totally separate bits of geometry. So I could work with that. And I'll just work for a second. If you guys have any questions, let me know. Stop me from wherever I was, and I'll try to go back and figure out what I was doing for you guys. So I'm gonna go here, turn this on. I'm gonna go down to my modify topology, and I think I might close holes on this. Now, some of this is kind of probably a little, you're going to get like a little concave. It's not going to actually do it to shape. But, you know, with these things, when you slice something and you close holes on it, it gives you triangles on the middle of it. You can always re-dynamesh it. And it would probably change it back to either sort of like the same dynamesh, you know, quads with a few Y poles in it. If that doesn't work out, you could probably take it and just do something like let's go to our Z remesher actually really quick. I'll keep adaptive on maybe up to like 75. I'm not going to worry about curve strength, but I'm going to use the same resolution and just Z remesh it. I'll keep groups and Z remesh it. And there you go. It's a little bit better, and you could probably sculpt some of this out still. Oop, not slice. I'll take a clip curve. I'll do the same here, maybe. There we go. And inside this group, I'm gonna keep some of the shape. Dip into it. And actually, I'm going to use a mask here. And what I did was just mask the middle. It's still pretty low res, it's not super high or anything. So I'm kind of coming out of, I guess, Dynamesh is still on, but I'm just kind of working some simple tools on poly. But I wanted to mask it and then flip the mask by holding down Control key and tapping on the canvas. It'll flip it. And this way, I can do something like do an extra clip along somewhere like there and have it masked off, re-dynamesh it, see how it shapes up. Oh, that's not so group. Good. I'm going to actually turn groups off here. Use Project. Now redo it. So I could do this a couple of times and build up the shape. I need to sculpt it up, I think. Still low. So anyway, I just want to create some parts, you know, that I can build off of. Oops, there we go. Am I way too quiet? Should I turn up my mic? Sorry about that, Viper the Sniper. Let me have a look at my mic here. Let's see, I'll pause for just a second. Strange though, it should be okay. But if not, let me see here. Does that sound any better? Is it any louder? Or is it like, you can barely hear me? Actually, let's do this. Just for presentation value, I'll kill this for a minute. Can you guys hear me now? Pretty good? Test. Let me know if it gets any louder, because I think I have my slider for it like all the way up to the top, but if not, I'll try to make sure that I can get it right. Strange that it does something to the audio. Can you guys hear me now? Any better? That is the mic. If it doesn't work out, I can try to switch mics, but can you hear me any better? Good, good. Okay, so otherwise I'll try to just speak up so that you guys can hear me a little bit better. And I'll just kill background music and we can do solo here. But usually if I'm working with a DynaMesh base mesh, you know, something like this is where I'll take a start. And I'll use like clip curve to sort of shape some shapes up and then re-DynaMesh them. So this is probably, you know, since ZBrush 4, you know, this is probably not the newest thing, but it's still, you know, as I like to say, old tricks are still the best tricks. And it's sort of like a way that I'll sort of start. So I'll turn things around, have a go at clipping them off from different angles, and see how I like a shape. Because basically, you know, one of the things within ZBrush that is really a liberty is to take and start manipulating shapes like right away. Like it's very tangible for that. So I love it. But flip this around. I'll do something like that. Take a chunk out, re-DynaMesh it. I should probably step up a little bit. So I'll change this to 64, re-DynaMesh. Maybe go through, get rid of some of the old faceting that was around. And think about this as a proxy, I suppose. But now, once I have one shape, what I like to do is I like to go in and use some of the primitive inserts. So I'm going to use B, I, to go to the brush menu, and then I is in the insert or IMM parts, and I'll just grab the primitives, right? And from this, I use a lot of the base pieces, but to preview any of these to select them, all you have to do on the keyboard is hit M. And so I'll start with like something like using a Q-cube. And Q-cube is an insert is really handy. With R8, I noticed that it popped up as a new piece. And so when I use it, especially within symmetry or something like that, I'll go from the side and I'll just make a piece. And then I'll split that piece. And then I'll start to manipulate just this. So just to select it, because it's still on the piece that I actually drew it out on, I'll hit Alt and click, and it'll jump subtools over to the new piece that I just inserted, right? So I'm going to go and hit W, Y, grab my regular transpose, and I'm just going to go from this side, this end here, this being the part that's not going to move, I'm just going to pull this down. And maybe from the side, pull it out. Move these out a little bit. And so now I can kind of work on some of this. So if I hit Shift F, it's just a simple 4x4x4 sort of like rectangle. And now I can start using the Z modeler to do a few things that I want to do. Like, for example, if I'm going to go and start editing some edges or the faces, I'm just going to do nothing to the face, nothing to the actual point, so that way if I misclick on either the face or edge or, you know, what have you, anything other than what I'm going to be doing, it's set to do nothing, so that way I won't make a mistake while I'm in misclick and actually cause a feature to be enabled where I didn't want it to. But let's see here, I just want to take and do this to curve. Actually, that may not work with symmetry on. Somehow it's too close. I want to to see if I could add a curve there, but you know what? I think I'll just go ahead and do like a regular bevel and stretch that out. Or no, you know what? Do it from this side in Sim. There we go. And of course, you could take these, hide everything using solo. A lot of times I'll turn dynamic solo on. It increases sort of like the way that you could turn an object. And I'll actually Q-mesh a few other parts out. So with this, I'm just going to do like a single poly, which means that I need to hold down the Alt key and click on it. And select one poly and then another. And then I'm just going to pull this out. And then I'm going to, along the edge side, actually do an insert. And what I want to do is actually pull out some of the geometry using Q-cube and create sort of like a steeped shape along the back of this. So what I'm going to do is I put an insert in just so I could terminate this poly. And then I'm going to select again, Alt-clicking here and here. And then I'm going to Q-mesh again and just pull it up. Now you see how it's snapped and there's a little bit of space here that's left over. If I didn't want to do that, what I can do is actually hit the space bar again, Q-mesh, and check these settings, and I can go a full step as opposed to a tenth, quarter, third step, half step, on up to a full step. So I'm going to actually click full step, and I'm going to click up, and that would bring actually the poly all the way up. So going backwards, if I did it again, and let's see, doing something like, let's do half step. There we are. So I get some geometry with a step at the bottom here, and then I get this little steeped area instead of having to actually extrude and then pull the actual loop out, or poly faces out a little bit. So I'm just going to kind of try to custom tailor a shape here really quick and block it out. So I'm going to insert here, maybe in here, do like here, create an insert mesh, and I'm trying to keep in mind a few areas that I'm going to fold in using Q-mesh. So maybe something like, I want to create like a thigh piece, like a hard surface thigh piece, and so I'm just going to take this part and this part, we'll take this part and this part, and I'll Q-mesh it inwards. And if I Q-mesh it inwards at a full step, it'll literally snap, pushing in the geometry. So you see there? Oops. And then I can do it again here. And even from the other side, if I wanted to do it, click here, 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 and here, and here, and here. Let's see what happens if I push that in. There we go. That could work. Same thing for this and this. And maybe I'll take this here and this here, pull this out a little bit. And with that, I think I'll actually do like a half step. And there we go. So I'm going to play with the shape a little bit. So I'm going to do a few other things. Here, I think I'll do an insert. Oops. Yep, see, there's a reason why I do nothing a lot, because every once in a while, if you misclick off, sometimes what'll happen is the face will be changed, but you think that you were editing an edge. And so just to cut down on some of the confusion, doing nothing here, and then maybe doing nothing on that point, and only working on the edge, right, might be a good idea. Oops, actually, cube mesh a few more times in a few spots. Sometimes even more so than doing an extrude. This is kind of a cool one. And it separates some polygroups every time. So like, again, if I wanted to take Move Tool or Gizmo, click on the inside, you can affect what's masked and what's unmasked by just clicking on the polygroup. So, kind of handy. Let's see. I want to move some polys around, I suppose. So I'm just going to do some masking here and here, and here, maybe up here. And whatever vertices that I'm probably masking off, they're not going to move. So if I wanted to, I could probably use like the Move Tool and push it outwards, or turn it, or what have you. And then finally, of course, every time you look at these, when you want to preview the mesh and see how it's going with the shaping of it, you know, like if it was to be subdivided and then you want to see how it looks, you could hit D, which is the actual subdivision. Always yes, and you can see, I think I actually selected something on the inside and pulled it in by accident, but let's try that again. Mask that off. I can unlock the gizmo and turn it about, or either redraw the widget for transpose line, and it would go in the direction that I need it to go into. So I'll pull something like that out. Okay, so let me show you guys something that really cool. That's something that I've wanted to talk about for a little while. So like, if I wanted to take these blocked out pieces and then later edit them as a Boolean mesh. So what I'm going to do is actually take, this is really low, of course, geometrically, right? But I can use some of the other insert primitives like I was using and cut out some more sort of like interesting shapes. So let's say, for example, I do a little bit of maybe creasing so I can surface this a little bit better. And I could take BZ, sorry. I'm going to go back just for a second, and on these edges, I'm going to crease along a partial edge loop. And what I'll do is, every time I do this, a crease is basically a sort of hardening of a looped edge, right? Like physically putting a crease into it, so that when I subdivide it, none of these edges will really change in their hardness. And we can actually edit that, so that's kind of cool. I'm gonna go along here, maybe crease this. I didn't know this until I kind of found it by accident. Is everybody with me? Any questions so far? Maybe possibly with Twitch. I'm sorry. Yeah. Still trying to work through presentation stuff. Every time I log on, it seems like maybe something changed, or I need to go back and have a look at the settings for something. So sometimes it happens. So bear with me. But if I can fix anything, I'll definitely stop, take a look at my settings, and make sure our stream is dialed in correctly. Okay. So you can see from this, like, a lot of these shapes are hardened, right? And even while I'm in dynamic subdivision, I can still make changes and add creases and sort of see how things are shaping up, right? Maybe somewhere in there, there's a crease that needs to happen. Maybe right, oops, turn it right there. There we go. Right there. There. Sometimes I can go along and just like, if it wraps around the complete edge loop, I can take and hit the space bar, single edge, and I could hit Alt and actually edit that those creasing, selected creasing areas, and just take them out if I don't need them. If I feel that I don't I can get by without them. And I could just click on individual edges and see how things shape up. This is actually sort of a good way when you're sort of just doing some shape building. Oops. Need to do nothing on the face. Just keep the edge. There we go. So we're going to stay on that. And I can actually make this smaller. Keep clicking on some of these edges. There we go. And as you see, they get harder as I go around. Oops. There we go. There, there. A few more over here. And actually with that, I should probably do more like a partial. So I'll just go hover over the actual edge loop partial, click on it. It saves me some time of having to click all around in a lot of different areas. Probably here. Need one in here to keep that edge. And on the inside here. And maybe right about there. There we go. And there. Okay. So one cool kind of thing is you can go and set the subdivision level with dynamic subdivision, which is what one thing for hard surface why I love it. You can look at it super low, or you can adjust it so that you can have various subdivision levels that you need to carry over. So before applying, I preview these. So dynamic subdivision with this is actually on and active. It's highlighted. Smooth subdivision right now, probably at default, it's going to be around 2. Edge loop partial, no way. Sometimes it's good for a few things. Every once in a while, if I do it, I have to go back and take a few creases out. But I wanted to show you guys something really cool, actually, that I didn't realize is there. When you change the dynamic subdivision levels, of course, you get more resolution. But just keep in mind that whatever level this is, it's actually going to translate to one more than it actually is. So in other words, like if it's 2, that you're probably subdivision level is going to be 3. If it's going to be all the way up at like 6, it's or 5, it's going to be 6, and then 6, 7, so forth, and so on. But probably on up to 7, going to 8 subdivision levels, which should, once you hide the polyframes, it's going to be like super sharp, right? For this, I think I only need to drop it maybe to 5 and get like 6 subdivision levels. If I need to subdivide it again, I could later do that. But you can notice that these crease levels are pretty sharp, pretty hard. So I want to open up the crease menu and take a look at it and see what it's set to. So right now I have a crease tolerance of 30 and the level is 15. I can change this. So to come out of dynamic subdiv and maybe, like say if you had a metal piece that was molded metal, instead of it being like laser cut sharp, you could dull it down a little bit and make it look like it was more sort of like a milled look, and we can keep going. So I'm actually going to hit Shift D and come out of the subdivision or dynamic subdivision, which is, you know, if you were working in another app, it would be the same as say like Maya has its Turbo Smooth or something like that. It's almost basically about the same thing with a few more handy things about it. So I'm going to actually change this tolerance, and I'll make it like say 70, and I'll bring the crease level all the way down to like say 3, and if I hit D again, it'll actually show me the updated creases, right? So I kind of like, I didn't know this, but I was like, oh wow, that's awesome, because I always thought you have to set it once and be done with it, but it's actually not. You can change it, so you can change your creasing and get a sort of like different result out of doing creasing and stuff like that. Here, when I do subdivision level, one thing that I should probably point out is you see how soft some of this area is. It doesn't look very tight or stenciled at all, as far as like thinking in a hard surface sort of manner. But you could hit Shift D, come out of that, Shift F, and look at your polyframe, and you could use the Z Modeler tool to sort of fix some of these up. You could add something like reinforcement. If you're working high poly and it really doesn't matter topologically what you do, you could always come in and just, you know, do an insert and sort of add some like reinforcement edge loops and stuff like that. which might harden it up a little bit. You could do multiple inserts, or multiple edge loops, sorry, and probably do something like put more than one in it, but I don't think it'll work really well for this, so I'm just going to use a single and place those sort of close to the edge, but not absolutely to the edge. So now if I hit dynamic subdivision, it looks a little bit cleaner, a little bit more uniformed. And while you're in this preview, it might be a little performance-wise slower, but you can actually come and add sort of these things afterwards. It's probably going to be a little heavy, I don't know, depending on how much GPU or memory maybe you have, it might be a little bit faster, I'm not certain, but you can always sort of clean up your edge loops and add reinforcement edge loops to kind of make things a little bit sharper. I'm going to come in here and add one more here and here, and maybe also up here at the top. Oops. There we go. Edge loop hardcore? Yeah. Multiple edge loop is hardcore. Sometimes it works with simple stuff pretty good, where you need to place one and then the other on the other side and really break something up. It's handy to use it. But sometimes it has some really funky results if used the wrong way. So I'm just going to put a few more there. That should be good. Because basically what I wanted to do is create like some hard shapes that I can later kind of edit out. And I would use sort of inserts to do that. So if I wanted to, I'll just go ahead and come out of dynamic subdivision for a minute. And I'll add some shapes that I want to use. So again, BI, going back to those insert prims. And I'll take maybe something, another shape, and I'll draw it on. Right, that looks cool. And one of the things about my UI that you'll probably notice is there's not a whole lot of like customization that happens in my UI, but you can hold the control and slide this, of course, because I have sort of an extended menu of things set up at the top. I'm gonna usually use a lot the split unmasked points. It's the same as everything, I think here under subtool, split, and you can do split groups, split to similar parts, split to parts, split unmasked points, split masked points. In this case, I'm going to use split unmasked points. Yes, in fact, you know what? If you hit Shift M, I'll just use the loop tool, and you can see this split menu, right? So I'm going to be using the split unmasked points quite a bit. So every once in a while, if you see me come up here and tap it, I have it actually as a custom put here into the top of my UI. So just for like a few quick button tools, merging down, merge visible, close holes, mirror, unify, those sort of things, just to keep sort of a few shapes in order. So I'm just going to insert something, and what I'm doing is I'm actually on my way to doing like some booleans, and I'm going to show you guys really quick how to do like a simple boolean using some of the boolean tools in ZBrush. So I'm showing all now. I've come out of solo, and one of the first steps I need to do is go over to the render menu and actually render booleans and hit live boolean. Now, the thing about live boolean that might confuse some is, especially if you're using showing the polygroups, is if you hit Shift F and then you start setting things up as a boolean group, your main shape first needs to be checked off as a start, right? And then the second, probably either additive, and then in this case I'm going to use subtractive. So I'm going to click on the subtractive preview button there. And when I do, you notice that it has sort of a funky preview of the polyframes. Worry not. This is A-OK. But I'm going to turn it off. And now it's just disappeared. And that's all because I'm using in the render booleans live boolean. And at this point, I could use the widget, you know, the world space widget, or gizmo, and push it into the geometry, right? So whatever resolution of the shape that you're using, if it's cleaner or not, this is just a simple primitive, and therefore I didn't subdivide it, and therefore, if you really look at it, it has some faceting on the inside of this, right? This is sort of like a stepped banding that's going on the inside of that shape. If I needed it cleaner, maybe changing it to a Dynamesh or something and keeping it super sharp, or making the resolution of pieces higher and then doing a Boolean might work. And I guess, of course, you know, ZBrush would try to interpret the shape and create topology around that, how it was taken out. So almost the same way, like if you were doing Booleans in Maya, if you cut some odd shapes out of each other, you might get some triangulation and that sort of thing, because it has to figure and calculate, you know, how to close up some of those faces and present the shape, right? So I'm just going to pull this in. You can even, if I was to take this shape and bring an additive again, hit solo, I can do some neat things with this. So if I look at the polyframes, I'm going to go back to my Z modeler. So in this case, I know that the shape is kind of generally good for what I want, but what if I wanted to do something like creating a bevel on this shape and then subtracting it? Well, you can do that. So I'm just going to come back, and along the edge, I'm going to hit bevel and bevel this out and do sort of some of the same things that I was doing before with like just creasing. So I'm going to crease and do like a, I'm going to crease and do like a complete edge loop around that. So right around there, I'm going to crease that, and again, of course, same thing on the crease menu. If you came down, it's just the same setting as before, so 70 and I think 3. Any softer than that, you could do that. But if I look at it, it's pretty much going to be shaped like so, right? And so this shape will come out of the larger shape. This I'm not going to worry about creasing or anything. It can be as is because we won't see it likely, right? So I'm going to take this and do a minus shape, come out of Dynamic Solo. And so now I have that nice little bevel on the inside of this. Sort of smaller details, but you know, you can do a lot of things with it. Take and turn it. If you hold shift, it'll go, it'll snap to angles, so 45 degree maybe. And of course, if you haven't used the World Space widget very much, the center, of course, this yellow box is to scale globally, and so you could probably scale it, but it's going to be whatever the center of the world space is. So you might need something like turning on the local sim maybe to like scale it in place. But you can also use the scales on the move XYZ move handles to scale things. So like if I pull it back, it's probably going to be a little bit shorter. And then at the regular conical part of that, you can pull it and just arrange it to wherever you want, right? So then let's have some fun with this. So now that we know how to do it, I'm going to add a couple of more shapes, and then we're going to finish the process of making a Boolean, because this is actually kind of fun to mess with. I can Alt-click back here, preview that dynamic subdiv again, and let's just say, for this, actually, if I was to keep going around with this, I might have to later apply the subdivision levels through dynamic subdiv that I wanted, and then maybe change it into a higher resolution mesh, but it usually, inserts can only be applied to objects that have one subdivision level, like none other, right? So it can't be like, I have 7 subdivision levels and I want to use an insert mesh. You would probably have to freeze it and then apply it, or you would have to kill the lower at the high and then insert, like say, a kit bash piece or an insert piece or what have you. So I'm actually trying to toy away with stuff like this, creating some workflows around building shapes. I think, let's see if I have a test of it around. Here we go. And so I could use something like maybe this. So you can make your own custom pieces. And then what you can do is you can insert them and they can create some interesting Boolean shapes. So this is just a piece that I made. I think a few of these I was trying to test out some shapes between ZModeler and also building some in Maya and see how they come out. But you can create a shape and then make it an insert mesh brush. And so for this, I'm just going to go back to my start object and apply a new one, a new shape to cut out. I'm just going to click it and drag it along. And it kind of went a little wonky. I didn't hold shift or anything to put it on. But you can always fix that with a gizmo and line it up correctly. So let's say if I wanted to take here, make sure that's straight. I'm going to split it. And then the same thing here. I'm going to undo its start, change it to a negative, and just start to... Oops, sorry. Pushing the wrong shape. Yep, that should be right. Actually, let's bring this down, because it actually... Everything needs to extend from the start. So if this is the start, and this next shape is under that, then this shape is under that. The Boolean will be considered from the start down to what it is. I'm actually going to kill this shape because I don't think I'm going to use it. So I'm going to delete that. And just so that you don't get confused, it's the start and then these two pieces are negative shapes. So if I hit W here and start moving this in, it should... Oh, whoops, wrong shape. There we go. That's the shape I wanted. And this should be negative, and that should be negative. Right? There we go. Sorry, it was a little farther apart than I thought it was. So I'm just going to place this on the inside, and change it back to a negative, and we'll start to see what kind of shapes can be generated pulling it out of the geometry. If I keep going in, it's going to pick up some of the surface, create some nice details. So normally, you know, conceptually speaking, for speed, like, it would take me a long time to, like, literally go in here and just start chopping this up. But I can use booleans to do it. I'll do a lot of the work. So as to create some nice surface noise or surface geometry, you can intersect some of these parts, and it looks really cool. So I'll do something like that. And you can actually continue this. So of course, with the world space widget, like whenever you insert anything, if you're going to add sort of a repetition of shapes, you can, of course, like any other geometry, you can hold the control, and on the widget, you can click on the arrow that you're going, or the direction that you're going to, and hold shift, and it'll make another piece, and you can maneuver those. And it's on the same subtool, so of course I can use it again or change it. So let's say if I want to rotate this side, just barely, right about there. Keep pushing it in. There we go. And so the same detail can use, and then I can clear the mask. And just as a base, let's say I want to go with this, and so I'm going to cut out some shapes, right? I'm going to go ahead and leave these for a moment because I want to add a couple of other things. For line, even for cut line, you can do this. In fact, I've been watching guys like Siki Vang, who was presenting at the ZBrush Summit last year. He did some really interesting stuff with some of the same workflows. I'm going to use primitives again, cube, and tap on the leg piece again, and just draw out a simple cube because I want to edit that, split it, click on it, selecting it, undo its start, and I want to view the polyframe on it. I'm just going to come out of live boolean for a minute. So basically, when you see all of these shapes, this is what they look like. If you imagine it's sort of if they were all visible, this is what they look like. And with the live boolean turned on, because of, you know, these being a negative, they're coming out of this larger shape, right? I can even take this cube here. There we go. Line it up orthographically to the side, I'm gonna turn this off for just a second because I want to work on this piece. I'm gonna stretch it out. Actually, I'm gonna use the transpose for this. There we go. And from the center down, make it a little thin. You could probably use this with a plane, but I also wanted to try to cut some pieces up that were just like a solid plane with thickness, because I'm actually going to cut it out of this. And of course, you know, again using Z Modeler, you know, you can sort of toy with it. So for there along the edge, I'm going to actually do an insert, creating a couple of steps right about there, and then again here, and again here, and there we go. And I'm just mask off, I think this, and this, and use the move, which is W move tool, hitting Y, and use the gizmo and create sort of like a step. And this is just like a simple shape that I can use. So this is one way, but I can also do this with kind of like using curves. So if I push this in to about right here, and then of course if I widen it, oops, let's do this and widen it. There we go. So that really cuts in, right? And then make this a negative piece. Turn our live boolean back on, and if I turn off the polyframes, you've cut into the geometry even more. Right? So that's cool. And then you can also use this with curves. So if I hit B and C and use curve tube, just for example's sake, let's find a good spot. Maybe in and around here, I'll take it. Oops. No. Let's do maybe up here. There's one shape. And since this is actually on the same subtool, I can make this different because I actually want to do some other things, but I can split it, but it's actually still part of the same. I'm drawing it, and it's snapping probably along the surface, and if you wanted to make sure that it is, you can always look at stroke, look at your curves, and so I'm using a curve mode. It can bend, and I'm actually going to lock start in the finish and have it snap along the surface. So you could do something like this, and you could get some straight lines, but you could also, you know, draw a different line and cut across, or I think if you do it off to the side, it would probably reorder the line like that. What I was actually thinking to do is actually, if you hold shift, you can wrap it around an object, sort of like so. Like if I take it and I draw it off the edge, it should be able to wrap. For some reason, it's not working right with me. Anyway, I'm going to go to about here, and then continue this line up here. And usually if you draw out, there's like a red line here. If I draw it out, I can always bend it into shape and do what have you. But let's try a simple line. There we go. And it looks like it didn't snap, so let me actually take this back step. Flanagle this around a little bit, see if it works right. I'm gonna split it and then bend it. I think for some reason it's not snapping to the surface like it should for some reason. Oop. am I still quiet on the mic? I'm sorry if I am. If for some reason, I'm not sure why, but my mic setting seems to be a little bit quieter than usual, although its mic level inside of the streaming software is actually turned up to its max. So if I need to speak up a little bit louder for some of you guys and make sure that you can hear me, I do apologize. For some reason, it's just not copacetic today. It's temperamental. But there you go. I mean, you guys get it, though, right? You can probably take it and bend it a little bit more. Get your shape going. Or you could use tube shapes, or you could probably even use, like, a... you could probably use some shapes from Z-spheres, even, to create like a tube shape. Or you could use other kitbash pieces. So, like, let's say, for example, I have a lot of different kitbashes myself. What if I took some shapes of my own somewhere? And I wanted to add other details, like this one here, which I would have used to use for Dynamesh. But now, if I wanted to, I could add them to an actual shape. So, do something like this, split it, take this, make it not a start. So I have to uncheck this start and make it a negative piece, turn on the gizmo, and pull it until it's inside the geometry, right? And so now, what if you wanted to work with these pieces? So let's say if you wanted, you've blocked out enough, you have like a simple shape that you want. Now you want to make it a union mesh, right? Like all one deal, one subtool with everything already plucked out. So now for that, you need to actually go down and go open up the Boolean menu. So I'll shift and M this with my loop tool so you can see it. So Boolean, make Boolean mesh, and you can do this with dynamic subdivision turned on if you wanted to. For this, I'm actually not going to do that. I'm just going to straight up cut it out. And so, with that in mind, I'll proceed. I'll take this, and on the Boolean mesh, I'll just make Boolean mesh, and it makes it. It takes a second to actually calculate. Probably no more than like, oh, you know what? Somebody mentioned leprechauns. Happy St. Patty's, everybody. Forgot to mention that. Anyway, it's made a Boolean mesh. And so when I look at this, everything is still in there. And actually, I can kind of compress this because if I click on this, oops, that is the start. If you click on the actual start, it'll compact everything that was in that group, that start group. And now I can come over and just use the append and add the shapes that I was building. Right? Probably under the same start group. I put it at the bottom. But I could move this tool and use it anywhere I wanted to. So let's raise it up. Pass that. Hit the start here. Close that, and now we can work on just this, right? I'm going to hide that. So none of those other older or previous pieces are on the inside of this. I'm going to close it and actually turn them off, hide their visibility, rather. Hit start and compact it, and just work on this, right? And if I wanted to look at how the topology came out, hit Shift F again. And you can see there's a little bit of areas where it, like it does some triangulation to, you know, sort of close up holes or recalculate some of the topology. And of course, you would probably have to re-topologize this, but as a Boolean, it works pretty decent. Or you could Dynamesh it. You could also use some of the polygroups. I'm not sure if anyone's worked with this, but you could Z-remesh something like this. A lot of times I like to take stroke curves, go into curve mode. Actually, sorry, and frame the mesh. And if you frame it by, say, just by polygroups, and then all of those will be outlined. Whenever you come over to your ZRemesher, you can turn the curve strength all the way up to, like, say, 100. I'll turn adaptive off and see what happens. Keep groups and ZRemesh it. So depending on the resolution, it might be a little cleaner or maybe not, but something you can definitely toy with. You get, like, your clean shape broken down and topologically, right? Speaking, that doesn't look so great, but maybe the strength is a little too high, and maybe the resolution is a little bit too low. But you should be able to use curves and ZRemesh it and toy with it and get it back to sort of like its original shape, or either go low and then use projection to project the shapes back into. I usually like to hand topo things all over again when I finish shapes like this, but or use it in Dynamesh. But anyway, let's go back. Delete curve functions, so I'm going to mess with this a little bit. Any questions in mind? What am I doing here? I think Crystal Voyager, what I was going to do is actually just take today to do sort of like 2 hours of me just messing around doing some scratch building. Sort of like a 2-hour crunch, and I may continue this, but just wanted to show you guys, because I think in a few times I might have done it and not really explained it, or in future tense I might do it again, but I'm using a lot of the booleans just to block out a piece of mesh for hard surface. And then of course, you know, later on I've showed you guys workflows for taking some of these things in previous streams and changing them to line art, or either going and creating a paint over in Photoshop. So basically I'm doing illustration via 3D to sort of get a few things designed and worked out properly, and then coming back and doing stuff in either Photoshop or KeyShot and rendering things. But I wanted to try and do some Boolean stuff today. So I started working with just like a hard surface waste section. So like maybe if you would imagine these are two thigh pieces, and this later will be sort of like a cod piece to a mech. And then maybe in between we would have mechanics. You could certainly do some things like that. But I wanted to show also quick building, like sort of like a concept mesh using a lot of insert primitives, and how you can derive some shapes from either that and or sometimes from kit bash pieces. So something like this. You'll have to excuse me. My peanut gallery is carrying on in the other room with mom. But you could take something like this and quickly turn it into a Boolean, nice, clean surface. So I actually want to come back to this and maybe just polish it out a little bit. So any of these pieces, you know, naturally, you know, between Dynamesh mode and or creating a Dynamesh base mesh, also sometimes coming to ZModeler and sort of hacking out shapes into sort of like a concept mesh or concept base mesh, you can kind of really explore where you are going creatively, which is a big part of a lot of what I do. I like to play with shapes and not be committed or married to the idea of certain shapes. Redynamesh this and soften it up. Some areas here that kind of got a little funky. See, normally when you use like a clip curve brush, sometimes depending on the resolution, it gets a little jaggedy because there's not enough resolution to redynamesh it and have it come out clean. These are areas, especially where, you know, doing something like having a Boolean is really nice. I'm gonna turn off symmetry. Come back to this again. I can place it and straighten it out again. Oops. It's wrong keys. I swear to God. Sorry about that. I think I actually messed up something. To create a first kit bash, I would start definitely with something with a Z modeler. Like if you were gonna make your own kit bash pieces, start poly modeling them out with like a basic primitive shape, and then you know just think smart when you work them out, and generally they come out pretty good. That's what the problem is. Oops, for some reason this seems to be dropped to the canvas for some reason. I must have accidentally pushed something wrong. Oh well. There we go. There we are. Okay. Back to where we were. Sorry, I misclicked some things. Sometimes I work a lot between a Mac and a PC, and every once in a while I will start to confuse some of my left-handed key controls because I keep my left hand on the keyboard, and I'm thinking Mac but using a PC, and I mess up and I accidentally click on something I'm not supposed to. And that's what just happened. You're not supposed to see that, but sometimes it happens. Sorry about that. All right, let's move forward. I want to take actually this piece and sort of stencil cut it out of this and make it a little bit smoother. So to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come down to my menu again and split unmasked points, makes it two separate ones, and then I'm going to hold Alt and just click on the box that I inserted, and then I'm going to start to shape it. So maybe using the Move tool again, I can pull and scale this wide. And then I'm going to take and bring a mask over those vertexes here at the top, and then basically using the transpose, I'm going to take and use Y and move this bottom row in, clear the mask, draw out the transpose, hit W, hit Y, and I'm actually going to use the scale box on the widget to pull both sides out. And then what I could do is take this shape, pull it down, and see how that might intersect with those shapes, and then I can totally just cut it out. So again, going to your render, live boolean is already active. I could look at the subtool and take this major shape and clip it out of this, basically. So, a lot of times with Dynamesh, you could do the same thing. If you took this and subdivided it, you could subdivide it and still keep the edge by just taking and subdividing it with no SMT on, probably. So, under the geometry, like if I hit Control D. Sorry, actually check that off, and then Control D. Literally, I have a mesh that's this dense, but it left the edges that I put into it. It's subdivided, but it still retained sort of the basic primitive shape that it had. And then I could take and delete the lower subdivision and use it without booleans. So if I didn't have live boolean up, and if I Dynamesh this, sorry, there we go. If I Dynamesh this, it's a 64 Dynamesh now. If I re-Dynamesh it, still holds its shape. And then I could probably turn this into a negative Dynamesh and pull it out. So So if I change it to sub, and then if I took the two shapes and I merged them together, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do take this one and raise it above, and then merge it down. Yeah, that's fine. And then if I redynamesh it, oh, it has to be fully visible. Sorry about that. You know what? If I wanted to still split it, I can still split it. I'm actually going to take click on this piece. They're still apart. It says one piece is actually hidden for some reason. I'm not sure exactly why, but I'm just going to move on. Take this piece, pull it out of this piece. To do so, I'm going to take and do another boolean and make that a start and this a negative piece. And I'm probably going to get the cleanest result this way, but just taking it. Live booleans are on. This is a start group. Oops, actually it has two pieces. That's why. Sorry. Unstart that, hide this, take this. This is a negative. So now you can see that it's actually pulling out of the shape. Sorry for the confusion. So with these I can always, you know, change the shape using the scale and make it cleaner. You could probably duplicate this shape again. And if I flip it over, I can bring this up and make it another shape to actually pull and hide out of this. So I can flatten that top, and I'll make it a negative piece. And it gets cleaner, right? And then again, to take this, you know, just work the shapes a little bit, and you can really get some nice stuff out of it. I'm going to duplicate this again. And do something from here. Rotate. Actually rotate this way. Oops. There we go. And change this to a negative. So that way I have a nice pulled out piece here and it gets cleaner. Right? Go back to this shape and I'll do it again. This time I'll try something like a insert cylinder, and I'll do it along X, taking this L-sim off that might have been caused some problems. I think probably I need to make sure sim is working right. Sometimes it always confuses me with L-sim. Sometimes it makes stuff that's kind of off. Pedro, I'm sorry, you had a question. Let me pull my browser around so I can read it, cause just the last part. When you create a kit bash pieces, are you doing looking for something specific or just improvised? Usually, sometimes, I look at some references. I keep a very detailed, I call it surface skins, but it's like a Pinterest board, and it's nothing but, like, mechanical references. More like surfacing details, gizmos or latches, screws, rivets, spacecraft, aircraft, Gundam, Gunpla images. And I use that as sort of a visual library to sort of familiarize myself with how I am building shapes. So for something like this, you know, I keep adding shapes and I see what works. And sometimes it takes me a few times. That's why you'll have to forgive me. And I've said this before, but it's kind of like watching dry paint dry on a battleship or something like that. But you just kind of have to leave yourself some room to experiment and find out what works good. Like here, if I say, you know, okay, well, the circle looks good there. Let's keep going and take out some other pieces. And then I'll do this, and then, you know, finally, at the end, maybe I might take the big chunk of it and dynamesh it until I have a nice sharp object, and then I'll retopo that, and I can work with it again using even the same workflow. So, like, if you'll imagine, if I keep toying with this and build it out, I'm going to try to do, like, a walker mech. And later, now that I've messed with these, I could probably take and turn the thigh a little bit, raise it up, push this around. If I add some more mechanics, let's see. Oops. There we go. Let's rotate these. And then move them. Right? So if you think of this as like a thigh piece, and this is like the center hip piece or carapiece, or cod piece, I guess it would be. Carapiece would be a chest, my bad. So just like as the pelvic assembly, I could put some mechanics in between here and keep going. For this, I'm building, still building the Boolean, so I don't want to really attach something too weird to it, but let's say for example's sake, I have some kitbash pieces that I made myself for just this reason. I hit the M, but I can use, you know, smaller parts to do a few detailed inserts, and then of course using the widget. There we go, turn it, move it into position. But I mean, there's still areas that I like to really sculpt up. So a lot of times it sort of blends itself in between building like absolute hard shapes and then some more organic shapes to come up with some interesting forms and like the overall silhouette. But when I kitbash, I try to think about, you know, is it going to work? How it would look in a positive and a negative space? And then the complexity of that. Does it really need to be that hard? Can I add some bevels in and get some interesting shapes? If I was to cut this shape away from another shape, is it very useful? Those sort of things. And then I build a shape around that. But I try to think within a certain amount of form language, I guess, that is either studied or, you know, considerably stuff that is in my muscle memory. Like if I draw pictures by hand, a lot of times I try to translate those into 3D shapes. I do work 2D a lot, and then, you know, sometimes it comes out more so to vision, and sometimes not so much, but I have to keep toying with it and give it some love and think about it. I could do something like this. There we go. These in, and this is not going to be a start piece, it's just going to be a regular piece of geo, and I'll split unmasked points on it. Yeah, no worries. Oops, I'm gonna click on this one. This guy is what I was trying to remove around. There we go. I think as a Boolean piece, it's intersecting with something else that it should not. In fact, I think this was our start, and somehow I might have unchecked it or moved it out of the way. Yep. That was the start of that. Okay. And this guy should be on top of this, outside of the group. But I think, for the items that I have shown right now, I probably need to hide additional pieces so that I don't confuse the shape and actually mistakenly cut something away. So I'm just going to check which ones are showing. I'm going to go back to this guy. And only the ones that are visible are going to be included into this Boolean group. So by showing some of the polygroups, I can tell if it's actually cutting through all the way or not, and then hit Shift F again and see what, you know, how it comes out. And then finally, you take all of these that are visible, and under the Boolean menu, make Boolean Mesh, and it ties it all together. To which you have to actually have to append it again. So let's see here. Looks like it's done doing it. So I'll take this start group and compact it again. And I'll come back up this way. And I will click on this guy and maybe do an append. And there's my new piece that I had before. And at the bottom, you'll probably see it as U-Mesh. So a lot of times when you do a union mesh with Booleans, it labels the tool U-Mesh, which means union mesh, polysphere 1. So I guess polysphere was the name of the shape that, you know, I originally started, you know, just like the default polysphere that I was working with, and it's a union mesh now, which I have to append back to my project. So I'll take this guy and do some things. I'll take this guy and move it up. There we go. One down. I'll hide that. Show this. So basically, this is kind of what I'm angling at, is having sort of a mech hip assembly. Oops. I'll click on this guy. There we go. Now we can rotate it. That looks good. We can bend it inwards, give it more of a hip feel, spread it apart. And you can sort of just work your layout, you know? And then I'm going to take the other union of the legs and add them in. And as you can see, as you keep building, it starts to become this complex thing, right? Like, I could keep building on top of this and more and more. But a base form with Booleans and then maybe like a little bit of kitbash, and, you know, you have some really quick concepting going on. I'm going to bring this in just a little bit, and I'm going to split this, and this will be like our leg joint that's happening. I can even play with this a little bit more. I'm going to split it first. Look at the polygroups and click on this. Let's see. Let's bevel this. Bevel edge loop complete, and I'll put another one on the inside. And I'm gonna crease that. Crease that. Crease here and here. So I'm basically just making a large industrial sort of servo cog piece to go in as a sort of like a knee joint, and I can sort of manipulate these and straighten them out as I need. Really handy now with Gizmo. So now you can see, just by turning on dynamic subdivision, dynamic subdivision, excuse me, my mouth is like tired. But you can change things around and kind of move it. Dynamic subdivision helps to sort of like look and see a sort of a preview of this. I can even work using radial symmetry a little bit, like if I wanted to create a detail, or let's see, you can even break it down to smaller details, like let's say if I move this edge and the entire edge, slide, and you want edge loop complete, you can do some interesting things this way. I'm going to pull this and move it out, and then along these faces here, like let's say I want to create like a sort of cut line wrapping around it, I'm going to insert another edge loop just right about here. I'm going to come out of dynamic subdiv. I'm going to move this back a little bit. Oops. Take this and slide it. And then along these faces here, I want to take and do an extrude, which I'm going to do inwards, and then I'm going to use the poly loop. So along here, and what I'll do is I'll click it and pull it in, and then on this edge here I'll go ahead and just crease it here and here. When I turn dynamic subdiv back on, it's going to be a nice little cut groove, almost like a edge loop. Crease that, and another crease on the inside of this line, so I can keep everything nice and sharp. There we go. And then I can change the crease level again, because sometimes every once in a while it might bounce back. Just check your shape. So I'm going to do, let's say 68 and maybe 4. Come out of dynamic subdiv and then hit it again, so like D. And you can see the changes in your crease settings happen generally. So that's kind of neat. Actually, let's go 80, and I'll drop this to 3. So maybe a little softer, I don't know. Maybe a little bit more resolution. So. Let's change it to 4. That looks nice. A little less banding along the front of that. I think I have some other parts I can probably hurry this up with. Actually, I'll split that one. And turn side dynamic sub. This is a non-subdivided piece, so I don't need it to really be done too much. But I can take it and rotate it, and this will be my kneecap for the Mac. And so basically what I have is just right now, like the hip and knee assembly. So if you would think these are the hip pieces, these are the thigh pieces, this is the joint, and this is the kneecap, and then I could build some more things underneath. But the way that I'm already getting a lot of details is from having used Boolean pieces. And so I'll go through this and just methodically sort of like do it over and over again and keep going to the process until I have some shapes that I really like. Even more so, if I'm not using any of the insert primitives that I have been using, I can take and use something like Z-spheres to pull out the shapes. So let's say, for example, if I appended a Z sphere, I could do that, and I'll just turn on transparency, and I'll do this on one side, and then I'll get it mirrored over. But when I hit Q, W, click on this guy, use the W tool to move it around and sort of get it into place. I'm going to scale it down just a little bit, and then I'm going to hit Q and draw out a sphere. Right? You guys can see that okay, right? So I'm going to pull this out. And draw a few more segments. So every time I draw more segments of this, it's actually adding another polygroup chained in. And you can preview the skin of this by hitting A. And so I can see this is kind of actually dense, probably more a little bit more dense than I want to work with. So I'm going to hit A again and come down on the tool menu and go to adaptive skin and drop this all the way down to 1. And if necessary, I can add dynamesh resolution to it. So right now I don't want to use that, but I'm just going to turn this all the way down to 0, and then hit A again, and I can sort of preview how things are shaping up with each sphere. So I'm going to create just a calf piece for a leg. It's kind of like a tippy-toe mech. Tippy-toe mech has a sort of like peg leg sort of design to it. I always love peg legs. They look kind of crazy. If they could actually stand on legs like that, that would be even crazier. So that looks about right. It's just a base piece. So I'm just going to go ahead and make adaptive skin. Come back. I'm done with the Z-sphere pretty much, so I'll hide it. Append. Come in here and create another... and append the actual skin of it. And while I'm on this, I'll take and because we're on the actual X, I can use the geometry tab, modify topology, and just mirror and weld, right? Oops, sorry, this has to be turned off. Mirror and weld, and there we go. So at least we have sort of like at least a proxy of the rest of the leg that we can build on. And I can even, you know, this is all geometry that, of course, that I can use. Let's say if I wanted to shape it up, I can move it. Turn it, maybe. Rotate it down. Move it a bit. Oops. There we go. Oh, you know what? I actually made some changes. And, this is actually a good example. I made some changes without symmetry. I forgot to hit X. So I'll show you how to actually, if you mess up like I just did, you can fix this. It's not a total loss. So it's actually on the other side of the X axis, but along it, between positive and negative. I believe this side would probably be the negative, and this is the positive. But it's either that or other way around. I always get confused with that. But it's along the X. But from this side, its left side, you can't actually flip it over unless you do something like using the deformation. So I'm actually going to take and grab the select rectangle, hide this. Oops, you got to come out of symmetry. Hide this. And you notice that when I did a drag selection, it actually went from green to red. That's because I'm holding Alt to get rid of it. And it's actually technically hidden. So I'm going to actually delete hidden. And I'm actually going to come down to my deformation, mirror it, and then of course go back up here and mirror and weld. And now hitting X, everything that I do should be in symmetry, if you're working in symmetry. Because every once in a while, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, for some reason I'm not exactly sure what's wrong with my mic. I have a snowball mic that should be able to pick up everything that I say, but for whatever reason it doesn't seem to be as loud as it should be. So I need to check the settings. I think this is only a problem for some reason on Twitch. I think everybody else can hear me pretty well. But if you guys can't hear me very well, I'll try to speak up. I actually have the mic turned all the way, or the actual input settings for it should be turned all the way up, so that you guys can hear me. But for future streams, I will definitely try to repair it and come back. I'm not sure why I am having a technical glitch with that, so I have to apologize. But of course, if you have any questions, type them out. I'll be glad to type back a response. Or hit me up. There's an actual thread that I've been setting up for you guys to show some of the ways that I complete a finished product off of some of these streams. So look forward to that. In fact, I should probably give you guys the link for that. I have been posting a little bit on ZBrush Central a little bit more. And can give you guys the address for that. But it has some of the previous stuff that I've been working on in ZBrush Live. I'm gonna have to come back and give it to you. For some reason, it's gonna be a little bit more difficult for me to grab the link. But I will do so. I will endeavor to do so, so that you guys, or just look me up and find me on ZBrush Central, and I've been making some posts. One in particular, very recently, I've been posting a lot of the finished works from this stream, and only from the stream. So look for that, because there's some really cool stuff I'm going to probably later post again, so that we can move along together and continue, and I might toss along a few assets you guys' way. Especially things for like doing line art and stuff like that, or materials and so forth and so on. So I'm going to take this and I just hit a couple of pieces. I'm going to delete hidden on that. And so just basically, I want to kind of create a shell of some things. I'm going to use the select lasso, do dynamic solo. I'm going to take off this cap here and just basically have that shell to work with. So I'm going to actually delete hidden, come out of solo. So I'm going to use this piece to basically build on some stuff. I can actually maybe subdivide it a little bit. Move some of these around. Subdivide it again. And I'm going to use Trim Dynamic to sort of shape some contours up. And turn transparency off. Just want to use sort of like a simple line here. Subdivide again. Ah, yes, that one, exactly that one. Thank you for posting that. I really appreciate it. I had to flip tabs and probably re-log in and do a couple of other things, but it would probably keep my hands off of the stylus and the keyboard. So I don't want to utilize this time to the fullest to sort of show you guys how to sketch something up as sort of like a concept mesh. And then I'm going to do another crunch where I'm going to try to build onto this again. And then we'll come back and we'll talk about it and see if you guys were successful in trying a few of these steps out. Because I really want you guys to kind of try some of this every once in a while, besides seeing me do it. Because if I do it, you should try to duplicate it. See if you can improve upon it. And have fun with it, Morrison. In a nut now, please. Sorry, my son is trying to con me out of an ice cream sandwich. Kids today, I tell you. There we go. So I'm going to use like just a few simple alphas to kind of create sort of a proxy leg that I'll build onto. So a lot of times, especially when I come up with geometry pieces like this, if I have no idea where exactly I'm necessarily going, I'll use subdivision and then sketch on the surface using the Damien standard. So that way I can kind of come up with some interesting shapes for later and sort of look at its silhouette before really committing. And then what I'll do is I'll just take like an average Z-sphere or maybe even the topology brush, and I'll use it to draw over new pieces of geo that I can then use. So, yep, that's kind of shaping. And of course, you know, with Damien standard, you know, I'm cutting into the mesh, but I'm also like, I am just thinking of this mesh as sort of like a sketch, like even if it was paper, but it's a three-dimensional paper that I'm turning around in a space to represent something in 3D. And I use the Alt key to sort of bring surfaces up that I really want to punch out. So I'll sort of sketch over the mesh in such a fashion. And I do this a lot with Dynamesh. Sort of raising the surfaces and then pulling stuff back down. Years ago, I think I saw something like this, sort of a method almost borrowed from Kurt Papstein. If you've ever seen some of his works, I mean, like a long time ago, he used to have a lot of workflows where he would, you know, work with Dynamesh and then using the clay curve tubes and pull out some and a curve, and that curve became like an arm and so forth. But you know, for like paneling and cutting stuff like this, you know, you go in and then, you know, you raise up the surface like so, right? And maybe around here you cut in. I don't really always worry about being straight with it, but I want to get moderately, you know, be moderately clean with drawing certain lines. And then I can always mask these off, change them by polygroup. Say if I wanted to use clay along some of those raised areas, what I'll do is I'll come and just build up some smooth clay in and around those, and then use the trim dynamic or hard. So I think probably everybody works this way, but nowadays, of course, it's easier to work with some geometry without having to really be concerned with topology as much. And so you could select some of these pieces by just polygrouping them and then cut them out totally, either through panel looping or, you know, like edge loop stuff, or either just totally splitting it by polygroup out and then edge looping that, which will clean it up, and then continuing to use it as a piece. So, you know, insert, boolean, Z-sphere, topology brush also works really cool for some stuff like this. Sorry, I was getting off track for a sec. So I'll raise it almost kind of like a plateau, and then use like the H-polish to harden it back up, shape it out. Every once in a while smoothing it, and that's how you form up some of those pieces. Yeah. Welcome, Tanuki. Is that anything like a tanuki? It's one of my favorite mythical creatures. I mean, it's not, it's an actual real creature, but it has some, it's steeped in myth, shall we say. Okay, so let's see. If I take this, and then if I hit, of course, the topology brush, I can come in and just really quickly make some parts. I need to freeze it. So now that I've subdivided this and built up a little bit of detail, I probably have to kill the lower a little bit so that I can use the topology brush over it. So I'll delete lower. I think we got what we needed out of it. There we go. And I'll take this and this. So now, having a go at the topology brush just to make one individual part. If you guys have never used the topology brush, it's a lot of fun. It builds geo basically to the size of the brush. And you can, it's based off of curves. So I can take this and continue from certain points and just pull the line down, and all of these little bits of overage that overextend this, I can just hold Alt and draw over the stem, and it'll disappear it. It'll cut it out. Oops, not like that. More like that and that. There we go. And every time these, of course you probably guessed it, but every time I close one of these quads, it highlights in yellow. If it was in red, I think it's actually a try, but it's just like using most other topology tools. It's actually kind of cool to use for quick pieces, you know, where you want some thickness or something. So I'm actually gonna draw to there, draw here, and with curves, a lot of times if you hold shift, it'll actually wrap around the object, which is kind of neat. I think I had some problems with it earlier, but I think I remember what it was that causes that. There we go with that. Cut this out. Cut these two off. Click to about here. And I need to toy with this because there's actually a section for some reason that's not connected right. There's a try, so I probably want to figure that out. Take this out, these two guys out, connect there. Actually, drop this down. There we go. So I can work around these pieces here shortly. Bring this up, close these guys off. Gotta work fast, we're almost done for the day. There we are. Cut that off. There we are. And just close this up. Be pretty general about it, but let's say if I wanted this as a shell, I would adjust my size of my brush, and if I just hold Alt and click on the mesh and then split it, Alt click on the actual piece again to select it, select the subtool. Okay, so this is the piece that came out, If I hit solo, you can see how it kind of came out, but just it's like a nice shell that I can then use. And if you look at it very carefully, you can actually tell that it automatically put some creasing on the inside edge loop. You can get like a crease along the edge, and then you can just go ahead and use the Z modeler on some of these parts. If I hit Q, of course B, Z, and Z model it again, I can add a partial edge loop. Just come here and crease this up and get it hardened again. If I hit D, you can see how it's shaping, right? So a really nice fast way to make some topology or geometry to further sculpt. I hit just the edge and hit these corners here. I remember back in the day, ZBrush 4, I believe it was 4R4, I think was one of the 4R4 and 4R5, but were about my entry when I purchased ZBrush, and it was kind of cool to use it back then, because I think you had to lasso a lot of pieces off and hide them so that you could crease them. Now you don't have to do any of that at all, and it saves so much work. So much work. So I come down here. Tanuki, did you know that there's actually a song I remember from my time in Japan about the tanuki. And if you'll forgive me, it goes something like this. Tanuki-san, tanuki-san, asobo janai ka. Which means, Mr. Tanuki, won't you come out and play? Ima benkyou no mensaichu. Which means the response of the tanuki is, sorry, I can't come out and play because I'm studying. Kind of like an interesting story, and that will be the first and last time I will ever sing on this stream. But there we go. And then if you hit, of course, the smoothing, the dynamic subdiv, you can see how, you know, you can just very quickly harden up a shell piece to use. Come out of here, crease that should be good. And of course you can add, you know, polys to it. So I'll just insert some loops. And then if I took here, I'll grab it by a few faces and do like a Q mesh on it or extrude. Either one of those would work. And I'm gonna use the faces there, and I can pull this out, and it's almost like panel looping, really. Let's see, bridge, oops, not bridge, bevel. Karaoke stream confirmed. That would be awesome. You know, it's so funny, when I was younger and I was learning Japanese, I worked at a Japanese restaurant. My former boss and I used to go to karaoke, and I had to learn all of these old Japanese like Inca songs, which were great. And it must have really tripped some people out to see me up there singing like old Japanese, like probably post-war songs that were popular songs. From what Japan, and they call it, in Japanese they call it like a Showa era, or the Showa period just after the war. A lot of like sort of lounge songs and stuff like that. It's kind of funny. Alright, so I'm gonna come out of dynamic, and then I've got my piece, and I can move this above the surface to sort of see how it is. A lot of times when I do a concept mesh and there's a dynamesh underneath, what I'll do is I'll just take a Damien standard and flatten it out. So like if I alt click on this, I have my shell sitting there, but I can just, you know, do something like this, and sort of get it out of the way once I've built the piece. And so I have the finished shell piece to work with, and then I'll just mash down the concept mesh underneath so it stays out of the way, so that the two don't intersect. It's kind of an old school Mike Jensen trick that I learned from his days of doing E3D tutorials. Some really good stuff, still poignant, still usable, still relevant. If you're looking for resources of learning different stuff, but you can move these around. And that's how you can just create like a shell. So there's a couple of different methods that I've used. Let's go over them just really quick today. One is I used booleans. Booleans with insert mesh. And then I also used Z-sphere to create like just silhouette shapes. When translated into geometry, I can take some of those and use it as a concept mesh in which to sketch upon. On top of using like a Dynamesh. The Damien standard as a tool. So if I took this and started sketching away in it, I can create some smaller details which are not really finalized, but just if I wanted to work out generalized shapes, I can usually sketch with something like using the Damien standard brush on a Dynamesh base mesh, which is just literally just like using it as a sketching tool. And then once I work out a lot of shapes, I start doing some surfacing. And by surfacing, I mean retopologizing and then taking those pieces and looking at them subdivided, editing them with by the poly using a dynamic subdivision and also the Z modeler to check out some pieces. And then we can clean these up and get them just as clean as some of these pieces up here. And then in final, probably later on, I'll go through and start showing you guys how to do some like topology on some forms and stuff like that. You can do refinements. So if you think of this as although this has like a few tertiary or secondary refined pieces, that's only by way of using it as it was like maybe like a kit bash piece where it's already detailed. But some of these I want to keep working forms and keep adding, maybe, you know, get the surfacing right so I can use some alpha stamps, that sort of thing. So, oh yeah, Nizmi, yeah, those tutorials were actually really great. I haven't seen too much of their new stuff. I don't know if they're still doing stuff, but, you know, back in the day that I learned a lot from just watching guys like Mike Pavlovich, Mike Jensen. Those early tutorials back when probably ZBrush 4 was about in its mid phase, those are great tutorials. I still suggest them to a lot of folks, you know, just because you can go back and nothing is ever taken out of ZBrush. It's always like an added. I think of ZBrush as like an Asian hot pot meal, right? And there's a base sort of ingredients that go into it, and then every time somebody brings some new ingredients and the flavor changes to the soup, it's just like that. Because all of the old code functions that are still built into there, and then there are new versions that come out that have new features, but the old ones, in case you're comfortable with those, never go away. So that's actually something I'm really, really thankful for. And it still runs like a charm, you know, throughout the years. So I'm mad appreciative of it. Okay, so I'm at 6 o'clock at the top of the hour. So this is just a short crunch that I wanted to do to talk about a few different features that I'm going to probably break out with later. So I thought today it would be fun to kind of do like sort of a progressive Mac. And I might work on this a little bit more, or either I'll hold off and try to continue it again into the next stream. But I at least wanted to sort of head start some shapes and get you guys a little bit more familiar with sort of like a working process or a possible workflow that's based around a few features. So I hope that does it good for the day. Oh yeah, he's a machine, man. His channel is insanely great. Like I think of it as a resource because it's so cool. Like even, you know, as versed as I could become with ZBrush, like still I'm learning. I think of it as a learning affair, one that you can learn and teach at the same time. So You know, share what you learn. Thanks again, guys. Thanks for joining me. Thanks, Pixelogic, for having me on ZBrush Live. Really love it and appreciate it. I'll see you guys again soon, and stay tuned. All right, have a good weekend. Happy St. Patty's Day. Happy St. Patrick's Day. Have yourself a good one. All right, thanks, guys. Have fun.